So refugees singing on the shores of Babylon, not super warm and fuzzy, but warm and fuzzy isn't always best. You know, we have Easter bunnies who are warm and fuzzy, and truth be told, a little bit scary. But really, like, this has nothing to do with Easter whatsoever. Aren't you glad you didn't grow up in yesteryear? Like, that's really terrifying. And some of you say, well, but those aren't real Easter bunnies. So even if you get closer to what a real bunny is, you aren't getting any closer to what we're celebrating here today. So bunnies are cute, and they are warm, and they are fuzzy. And maybe my title this morning isn't necessarily warm and fuzzy, but bear with me. This title and what we're talking about really does have connection very intimately with what we're celebrating here today and Christians are doing around the world. There's a secret to storytelling, and it says, Peter, you are turning the lights on and off back there. Thank you, buddy. We have light shows happening and people showing up. If anyone's behind me, let me know, because there's no scheduled people showing up, especially someone in an Easter bunny costume. That would terrify me. There's a secret to storytelling, and it's this. It's that the storyteller, whoever's writing the movie or writing the story, has to be really, really clear what is at stake, and we have to be kept wondering what is going to happen next. And if either one of those two pieces is missing, we don't care. Think of any story that you like and enjoy. It's because these two things were going on. Let me give you some examples. It's Katniss winning or losing the Hunger Games, and we go on that journey because of what is at stake. If nothing was at stake, there would be no story. What if District 12 all got cupcakes if Katniss won the Hunger Games? We wouldn't really care. We wouldn't sit there for a couple of hours and pay good money to see that. We care because of what is at stake. Winston Churchill led England in 1940 to 1945. And I've never met him, but I've heard he's super, super confrontational. It's just his leadership style. There was a fellow politician named Lady Astor, and he had this kind of running battle with her. And one time she said, Mr. Churchill, if I was your wife, I would poison your coffee. To which Churchill famously replied this. He said, Lady Astor, if I was your husband, I would drink it. This was a man who was basically bored with anything easy. If you agreed with Winston Churchill, he didn't care. And here's what's interesting. In Adolf Hitler, he found the enemy he'd been waiting for his whole life. Suddenly, the stakes were so incredibly big that he gave his everything to it, and he rose to that occasion. But even if the stakes are really high, and we're really clear on what the stakes are, we don't care if we don't wonder what's going to happen next. So we have to be clear on what's at stake, but we have to be kept guessing about what is going to happen next. In any story, if our hero marches straight to victory with no opposition, no weakness, no heartache, no tension, we yawn. We just don't really care about that. What if Luke Skywalker meets Yoda, gets his training uninterrupted, goes and hunts down Vader, and wins? The end. There wouldn't be many sequels to that. There'd be no Empire Strikes Back, because no one would go and pay for that story. What if La La Land were reimagined with nothing but success? So a struggling jazz pianist meets an aspiring actress, and they fall in love, drive off into the Los Angeles sunset, singing all the way. Blah. Some of you already are like, musicals, blah. This would make you doubly throw up, right? Because you just would go, we don't care. Here's the point. We don't care because it doesn't ring true. Being really, really clear on what's at stake and then wondering what is going to happen next. So it goes with all stories, including our own story. Perhaps movies keep drawing us as a means of escape. Sometimes maybe we go to a movie to see a life that's lived better than ours, or maybe just to avoid some of the chaos that's going on in our own story. But maybe they hold our attention because they actually make sense of our own story. They begin to put some pieces into place and we identify with parts of that story. And it actually begins to show us a picture and it's challenging our brain to take the next step. And sort of what happens next is left with us and it leaves us inspired. So this morning I have good news to share with you. And I want to be really clear, it's not my good news, it's God's good news. And it's God's good news as revealed in his book, the Bible. Now, we're going to do what we always do here on Sunday mornings, that is to open Bibles, physical and digital. And if you don't have one, there's a Bible sitting right under the seat in front of you. I would encourage you to actually open that up. Maybe it's the first paper book you've opened up in a long time. And you'll notice there's an English side and a Spanish side. Don't be confused in that. The original language was not English or Spanish. It's just that at this church, we have English and Spanish speakers. In fact, next hour, this room will be packed with mostly native Spanish speakers worshiping the same Jesus. It's an incredibly beautiful picture of the gospel and what God is doing. But if you would, turn open to Philippians chapter 3. If you know where Philippians is, you can ask your neighbor, you can look at the table of contents, or you can just look over their shoulder. But Philippians chapter 3, we've been walking our way through this book, and long ago, lined up on Easter was this passage. It's just too perfect for this morning. Philippians chapter 3, and I want to direct your attention to verse 20, some incredibly good news. He's talking to Christians here. He's talking to a church in a place called Philippi, hence the name Philippians, and he says this, "But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself." Pause. That passage is a prediction. It is speaking of things to come, namely that Jesus is coming back in power to complete something that he has begun in people. That's what this passage is talking about. And if you back up, we see the part of the story that we find all of ourselves in, and that is this, the what is at stake and what happens next phase of things. It's as if we've been given enough of the grand narrative to keep us motivated, but not so much that we lose interest. You do not know, nor do I, what is coming tomorrow. Some of you have had your life completely altered by a phone call, by a text. The events that you plan next week may not unfold the way that you think they are. And because of that, we have not lost interest. We're leaning in. This is just how God works. We have a clear framework for what's going on. It provides hope. It provides context. And he's always been very, very clear with us about what is at stake. He doesn't leave us guessing on that. But we've already been seeing in this letter that Paul's been writing, we must still press on. We must still walk forward. We must still take hold of these things that he says are coming. Part of that is simply living as if this were true. I have a hunch that many of you are in here at church on a Sunday morning, and particularly Resurrection Sunday morning, because of this, because you are here to lean in and take hold of God. Remind me and let me live as if it's actually true that I'm a citizen somewhere else. Let me walk you through this title sort of word by word, and it's going to kind of unfold this passage for us. Refugees singing on the shores of Babylon. It's really a picture of the life that Jesus invites people into. He invited people to follow him, to become his apprentices, his disciples, and the invitation goes out to this day. If you've ever heard that becoming a Christian meant saying a prayer, and then that was it, let me just tell you really, really bluntly, you've been misled. Becoming a Christian may involve a prayer. In fact, I think it does. Prayer is simply talking to God and hearing from God. But many have been misled to believe that I filled out a card at a crusade, I went forward and someone laid hands on me, I prayed a prayer. And they wonder why they're missing the whole story. It's because of this. The Bible opens up something so much different. Becoming a Christian is a radical redefining of everything that you are. It's so big and so all-inclusive that Jesus is the one who coined the term born again. He's talking to someone who knew all about the religious stuff, did more religious things than any of us in this room, and he said, you must be born again. He was talking about a totally different way of thinking and living. There was a whole new life available to him in such a way that he used this idea that you actually have to have a second birth. And that kind of language is really powerful. That lines up with the rest of Scripture. So let's take these words kind of one at a time. Refugees. Refugees speaks of the longing that we experience. You have the sense, sometimes more vividly than others, that you were made for something more. That your life and the meaning that you've been drawing from it or interpreting it, actually there's something far more than what you've been experiencing. And yet, we are a displaced people in a foreign land. This lines up perfectly with how God talks about us as eternal beings in a temporal body. This whole idea of being citizens of heaven while living on earth would have landed really, really naturally to the original listeners of this letter. The way these worked is Paul wrote a letter and it was sort of passed around to the whole church, read in front of the church, something like this, and then other churches would actually read each other's mail. And as the Philippians would have heard this idea of being citizens of somewhere else while living in a foreign land, Philippi was a little outpost of a little place called Rome. You may have heard of it. And as citizens of Rome, the only superpower of the day, they would have understood very, very clearly both the rights and responsibility of being a Roman citizen, some 800 miles from the actual city, but also they would have tasted the longings that you have, that you're not quite at home. No matter what's going on in Philippi, you're not quite home. And that would have just easily been transferred to these Christians. We had a gentleman who came here in a pretty miraculous way. One of the things that Jesus has done to many Middle Eastern countries is he's revealed himself in dreams to them, where it's illegal to have written things and all kinds of radio things are monitored. Several people have been at this church, and they have come because Jesus appeared to them in a dream and said, go to this church. This was one such gentleman. And I was thinking back on an Easter where we were here, and he was a normal face to us. We knew him really well. We knew his story really well. And he had his phone out like this, and he was just in tears. And he was in tears because his 16-year-old son and his wife were back in his home country. And they couldn't come here yet. And it looked like it would be years until they could be reunited. But on that Easter Sunday, they got to experience what was going on in his home church, his home away from home, via FaceTime. And it was just this really powerful thing to be able to say hi to his son for the first time and sort of get to smile back and forth this way. And here's what I know about that guy. No matter how great things were here, no matter how good his community, no matter how much we would have reached out to him, there would have been a yearning and a longing in his soul. Something not quite filled up completely, so long as wife and son are back in his home country. Make sense? You're a Christian. You're a refugee. Your citizenship is in heaven. Now, we have dual citizenship. Some of us may have three citizenships, but I'm an American citizen, but I'm a citizen of heaven, and that speaks to this sort of longing that's going to remain as long as we are apart from Christ. How about the shores of Babylon? Well, the shores of Babylon describes the struggle of living in a place where good isn't natural and opposition is normal. Does this describe your life? Where good isn't natural and opposition is normal. The good that we want to see doesn't come without a fight. And it's not just out there. It's actually right here. It's right inside of me. The very good that I want to see, the good that I know and can envision can be there, does not come without a fight. It doesn't come natural to me like breathing does. We live in Babylon, where good isn't natural. and where opposition is normal. If I were to take a poll, I would venture most in this room would want peace. World peace, inner peace, peace with their neighbor, peace with their spouse and kids, peace at work, peace at school, peace in the government. How much peace do you see right now? I don't know what you'd measure that, but I would venture to guess the answer would be unified, not enough. We want peace, and even peace, there's an interesting thing. We have to fight for peace. Again, not just out there, but in here. It's a struggle. It doesn't just come natural to us. Opposition is a normal part of being here. It's a description of what it means to live in Babylon. It reminds us that we don't get mistaken, that Babylon is not our home. This is not our final place. When we look around and say things are not as it should be, that can become really depressing. You can go really small with that, or it can blow your mind and go, praise God. God, that's exactly what you've been telling us. Help me not get too comfortable here. Help me not to attach my hope here in Babylon. Listen to the contrast of those who are not citizens of heaven. Here's in verse 18. Paul writes this, "For many, of whom I have often told you, and now even with tears, walk as enemies of Christ. Their end is destruction. Their God is their belly, and they glory in their shame, with minds set on earthly things." Do you hear the clarity part about what's at stake? What's at stake for the many who walk as enemies of Christ? Destruction. It's crystal clear on that. Again, we long for that. As story consumers, we want to know what's at stake or else I don't care. Paul tells us the clear thing is that their end is destruction. How about the shores of Babylon? Well, this makes me think of what goes on every single Sunday around the world. The refugees get to head to the beach. You see, refugees live in Babylon, and so all week long, all day long, we're in this fight, we're in this struggle, and there's rays of sunshine, but things are not as they should be. And on Sunday mornings, here's a little hint if you're new to the program, Christians celebrate not once a year, but every week, and not just really every week, all day long. The resurrection has so impacted our life, this is the born-again nature of it. But we come as a weekly gathering of refugees, and we come to the shore. We head to the beach. And it's taking a day's reprieve from all that surrounds. Part of how we keep hope alive is by reminding one another that this world is not our home. In contrast to maybe everyone else you spend time with all week long, our minds are not set on earthly things. And it's because of this that we sing. Christians have always been a singing people. And you know why? It's because we have hope. We have something to sing about. We're sure of what to come, and it causes us to sing. Verse 20 says this, "We await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ." We have Christ in full measure in some ways, but we will have it in full measures in other ways in days to come. Verse 21, "Who will transform our lowly bodies to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself." Christians sing because of what is coming. Jesus predicted both his death and his coming back to life. He actually did that repeatedly, but it didn't make sense because it didn't fit into the paradigm of his hearers. His hearers were being told things that they could not fit into their current framework and worldview. And Jesus did what Jesus does. He comes and sort of blows apart old frameworks and invites sort of new ways of thinking, even the idea of born again. There was a brother who was dying and a sister who was desperate, and this sister does what desperate people do. She cries out for help. She calls on Jesus to come to her, which he does. "Jesus, come save my brother." Maybe you've been where this sister is. Maybe you're there right now. Utterly desperate. No other channels of finding help or reprieve. And so you're crying out to Jesus. Only Jesus doesn't get to her in time. At least not on her time. And I so identify with that. Jesus doesn't often operate on my time. He shows up right on time, but it's not in line with me. Her brother dies, and she is hurt and confused, and she takes it up with Jesus. This from the Gospel of John, chapter 11. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Where were you? God, I am crushed right now. Where were you? You could have prevented this. She has good theology, doesn't she? But even now, I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give it to you. This passage is such a gift to people in pain. She offers her a complaint, but she's also pleading. Do you see her faith? Even now. In my framework, the story is over and done with, but I'm leaning in and trusting you, Jesus, even now. Is there anything you can ask from God that would change this scenario? She is very, very clear at what's at stake, but she doesn't know what's going to happen next. Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Remember the framework that Martha is operating, like all good Jewish people would have operated from that time. Here's what she says. "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." That's the framework. The Jews believe in resurrection. Standard belief was that, of course, there's resurrection, and it's real, but only at the end of time. But this is where Jesus blows apart her framework and takes her in a brand new direction. He says this, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." And then he asks a penetrating question to Martha, who's in pain and crying out to Jesus. He just asked a question, "Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe." Jesus is speaking to a refugee who's awaiting resurrection on the final day. Martha knows that will eventually come, but she lives in the tension that we all do, the now and not yet of that. So what is she to do with her pain and her loss and the despair and finality of death? She brings it to Jesus. Jesus literally blows her mind and blows apart her framework and asks a question, "Do you believe? Do you trust me?" To which she says, "Yes." He reveals something about himself here that she will come to realize more fully in the days to come. That Jesus has power over life and death right now, right here in this moment. Can you hear his own prediction over his own story that's unfolding? "Though he die, yet will he live." And that he'll live forever. Jesus was about to go and live the life that he demonstrated in Lazarus. And in Lazarus, we get this little sneak peek about Jesus' power over life and death. Apart from his own resurrection from the dead, it might be one of the most marvelous things in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. "Lazarus, get out here!" And he does. Much to the astounding nature of everyone around. So Jesus predicts his own death. Jesus says that he's God in a body. And then he demonstrates it with power while he was alive. And then he demonstrates it through his own resurrection from the dead. And that's Easter Sunday. That's Resurrection Sunday. That's why we began this morning like Christians do around the world. He is risen, to which everyone says, "He's risen indeed." This is a factual thing that we've pinned our life to. What's at stake is not just life or death, but life and death eternal. And this is why Christians have always been a singing people. Listen to these great hymns kind of yesteryear and how they all point forward near the end of the song. Hymns follow a pretty predictable format, just like modern praise choruses follow a pretty predictable praise format. But look at the looking forward nature of some of these verses. How great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. The church gathered and sang about his greatness, not just from yesterday, but what's coming. And they reminded themselves of that. How about great is thy faithfulness, pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. I'm not sure why, but several days in a row in the last month, I just woke up and the first thought in my head was strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. And I love that. It's like a gift from the Lord. Thank you, God. How about this? It is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day. Do you hear the longing? When my face shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trumps shall resound and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. And as we just sang, in Christ alone, no guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here is the power, here in the power of Christ, I'll stand. The often repeated refrain of Christian songs is hope. There's hope. Hope for today and bright hope for tomorrow. We've been in this series in Philippians called Oceans of Joy. And it's just talking about the idea that joy is possible even in the darkest storms. Paul's writing this from prison. He's writing this while being misunderstood and mistreated. I can almost assure you, he has worse circumstances than you do today. And yet repeatedly through this letter, he says, rejoice. Don't even not feel sorry for me. Rejoice with me over and over and over again. To read this would say it's not even just possible in the darkest storms. Joy is probable in the darkest storms for Christians because of what we know to be true. It's Jesus to Martha at her brother's deathbed. Do you believe this? Trust me. Come with me on this. This ocean metaphor is the good news that joy from God is massive. The joy of God is not a little thimble of water, it's an ocean. Enough to drown your hurt and your confusion and lesser pleasures of life. I don't know what you are longing for today, but I know that you know what I'm talking about when I speak of longing. Humans have this distinct trait in that we are filled with longing, to be satisfied sort of down at a soul satisfaction level. Think about dogs and birds and snakes and bunnies. They don't share this. I have two dogs, and most of the time they're wonderful, some of the times not. One is 11 years old, his name is Finn. One is 3 years old, he's a complete spaz, his name is Bondi. Now, as they are hanging out and playing tug of war, kind of wearing each other out, and then laying on their beds, sort of just hanging out, Finn doesn't ever turn to Bondi and in doggy language say, you know, Bondi, we have it pretty good here with this family. But I just have this sense. There's something more. Right? Like, they never think that. The only more that my two labs want is more food, more belly rubs and attention, and more fetching. That's it. That's all they ever want more of. They don't long for that which doesn't exist, but humans do. And humans go looking for it. We will not rest if we are not soul satisfied. Even when things are good, we have a sense that there is more. The offer Jesus said to the first disciples was, follow me. The question he asked Mary was, do you believe me? It was an invitation to trust me. And those same two things go out today, 2,000 years later. Trust me and follow me. That's what it means to be a Christian. That's why I say that praying a prayer or checking a card, that may be a great starting point. And I think there's great power in those things. I walked an aisle at a church 3 miles from here. Changed my life. But it wasn't the aisle or the card or the prayer, was it, that changed? It was being in relationship with Jesus. Or to use our language from today of refugees singing, it is that you are invited into the choir of Jesus. To join redemption's song as we just sang it. Because of the risen Jesus Christ. The Bible is really blunt about those who go looking for soul satisfaction and joy apart from Jesus. Eugene Peterson wrote a translation of the Bible for his grandkids. And here's how he translated Philippians 3:18. He says, there are many out there taking other paths, choosing other goals, and trying to get you to go along with them. All they want is Easy Street. They hate Christ's cross. But Easy Street is a dead-end street. Those who live there make their bellies their gods. Belches are their praise. All they can think of is their appetites. People go looking for their longings to have them met. They look for joy in their appetites. And I'm not just talking about food, but sex and stuff and power and praise. We're all tempted in different ways, but we're all tempted to find joy somewhere else. Isn't it true that these always promise freedom and satisfaction, but they never deliver? I mean, it's a really predictable storyline that we keep falling for. I don't know if you noticed this, but I would say I'm most vulnerable to temptation when my soul is feeling empty. That's when other things begin to look inviting. Maybe I've missed it. Maybe it's not here. Maybe it's something else. That's the human desire for longing. We won't rest until we have it. You know what the antidote is? Joy. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Strength for what? In part to resist lesser happinesses, lesser joys, to show them for what they are. If you're jotting anything down today, maybe write these two ideas down. That Christians, refugees, we sing for joy, not because every appetite is met, but because we are more than our appetites. That is really, really good news. We're not enslaved to the impulses that just say, feed me, right? And we just go after it blindly, knowing where that road ends. John Ortberg said this. He said, real freedom is not the external freedom to gratify every appetite. It is the internal freedom not to be enslaved to our appetites. He's just stating what this passage says. Pointing us in that direction. Jesus raises the dead, first himself and then others, but it's not just someday, it's now. He raises the dead in us. Part of being born again is being given brand new desires. One more place people hunt for happiness and has many people duped is worshiping creatures rather than the Creator. Worshiping created things and creatures rather than the Creator. This last Friday was my oldest son's birthday, and we decided to declare Thursday, bring your dad to work day, which is really amazing because he's a scuba diver instructor in Monterey. So we went diving together on Thursday and had an amazing time. Got to dive with this 16-year-old named Jack who's kind of just learning to dive, and we were out there under the sea, just kind of like seeing all of God's praises and just sort of the big and marvelous and vastness of it. And if you just get really close and just linger for a while, just all the intricate detail and color. Just utterly fascinating. Well, Jack had a rented wetsuit. He put it on for a while. It served him well. It kept him warm while he was under there. And then he took it off. He wasn't too attached to it. And Jack, not for a second, mistook his identity as being that wetsuit. Now, with this passage and this sermon in mind, I thought, what a perfect picture of our bodies. That they're rentals, that we borrow them for a little season, But we shouldn't get too attached to it. You see, on your birthday, in fact, before your birthday, when God thought you up at conception, he began to create a birthday gift for you. It's called your birthday suit, right? And he gifts it to you. Every single one of you got it without trying to do anything at all. And what the Bible tells us is there's coming another birthday present. It's like being born again is like our conception, and we're sort of, it's developing, the inside of it's developing now, but there's coming a day when we are getting a new and glorious body. The Bible is kind enough, God is kind enough through the Bible to show us glimpses of what that looks like. Just read of Jesus after his resurrection. So here's the second thing. We sing for joy because you are more than your body. Now, depending on your age and your genetics, you are more or less happy about this statement. Some of you are like, uh-uh. Some of you are like, amen, and praise Jesus. Hear me. No matter how rocking your body is or how rotten your body is today, it's a mere seed. The Bible says that Jesus will transform our lowly bodies to be like his glorious body. That means this: no matter what anyone says or thinks, including you, about your own body, it is not the sum total of who you are. If I would have said to Jack, I don't really like the colors on your wetsuit, he would have said, who cares, old guy? Like, okay. He doesn't really attach himself to the wetsuit, does he? Now, in a bizarre twist of fate, I had someone say to me, I don't often wear a suit. By the way, if you think the main problem with churches today is not enough pastors wear the pastor uniform of a suit, I have good news and bad news. Good news, welcome to NBC. Bad news is, next week, I will not be wearing this. This is not my normal attire. But I had a dear friend walk up, and she said, oh, you look like an Easter egg. Now, I have this truth. I have a hope of a future body. I don't think anyone longs for their body to be referred to as an Easter egg. I can't imagine any scenario where that's a compliment. But this dear friend of mine, she speaks her mind. I receive it in love. I hope she was talking mostly about the color. Band, why don't you come on up right now? I want to tell you about Annie. Annie had a body that was failing for years, and yet she made it obey so she could get to church. Took her 24 to 48 hours to prep the air tanks that she was attached to so she could sit in the back of our church service. And there came a day when she couldn't even do that, so we just brought church to her. I never knew Annie apart from a pretty broken down old body. If we could see Annie with spiritual eyes, you would say, man, Annie was more than her body. It gives me great joy as I read a passage like this. And we would talk about it often while she was here in this rented body. Can you imagine what your body is going to be like? What you're going to be able to do on that day? This body is a seed planted. You're being raised a redwood. We can't even fathom the differences. And it's going to last forever. So church, work out, eat well, take care of this rental because it's all that we have, but don't ever attach your identity or someone else's identity to what you see in their body. We are so much more than that. This morning's title comes from a Switchfoot song, and you're going to hear a song right now that just touches on so many of the themes that we worked on. And as we just sort of hear the band sing this over us, watch for the truths just sort of emerging from here. Thank you.
a tragedy. I take a deep breath and close my eyes one last time. One last time. Storms on the wasteland, dark clouds on the plains again. We were born into the fight. But I'm not sentimental. This skin and bones is a rental. No one makes it out alive. Until I die, I'll sing these songs on the shores of Babylon. Still looking for a home in a world where I belong. Where the weak are finally strong. Where the righteous right the wrongs. Still looking for a home in a world where I belong. Feels like we're just waiting, waiting, while our hearts are just breaking, breaking. Feels like we've been fighting against the tide. I wanna see the earth start shaking. I wanna see a generation finally waking up inside. Until I die, I'll sing these songs on the shores of Babylon. Still looking for a home in a world where I belong. Where the weak are finally strong. Where the righteous right the wrongs. Still looking for a home. Body's not my home, this world is not my own, but I still can hear the sound of my heart beating out. So let's go sing it loud. Oh, 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 oh. I still believe in us together. You and I, we're here. gather now, forever now, forever now, forever now, forever now, forever.
So good. Thank you, guys. You know, we began this morning, again, with this idea of what's at stake and what's going to happen next. And as we think about our story, as we think about what's coming, some of you in this room may be in the place that I was at one point in a church service. And I came actually with pretty low expectations of what was going to happen next. But God saw that moment, that message, that music, that atmosphere, that we were together now in that moment, and it changed my life. It involved an invitation. It involved a walking forward of an aisle. And I took that step. The step represented, yes, Lord, I do believe. We find ourselves in an interesting place here of what happens next. I don't know if you've ever caught a glimpse of yourself being really, really awesome or really, really awful. Little times where just maybe a handful of times in life where just everything is clicking. You're like, man, this, I feel like I was made for this. And it can kind of vanish, can't it? Oftentimes when we find like little glimpses of us being really, really awful, I mean like more terrible than we thought we could be, we'll kind of dismiss it, won't we, as I wasn't myself that day, or that's not who I am. But here's an idea that catching a glimpse of being really awesome, catching a glimpse of yourself being really awful, actually those are sort of pictures of our future self. How do you get from where you are to acting and living in your more awesome self and acting and living in your more awful self? There is a path, there is a heading that goes there. What the song talks about, what the scriptures talk about, this is not telling you. When it says, I want to say that I've tried, they're not talking about how to be saved, but how to live saved. Said this last week, that earn is not a popular word in the Christian faith, but effort is. And the path between here and awesome and here and awful is your behavior, your attitudes, your actions. We are living out who we are. And the invitation of Jesus is this: I want to come and transform you from the inside out. I want to offer it to you as a gift. Friend, it matters where you're heading. It matters who you're going there with. You see, everyone walks some road. Not everyone is walking towards God. Not everyone's growing up in God. Paul says here, with tears, there are people who think they are on the road to Jesus, but their lives tell a different story. They are headed in an opposite direction. Last week, I went to Valley Church. Valley Church is a church in Cupertino that planted this church 17 years ago. And I found myself back in a time warp. I was back there when 17 years ago. I was on staff there for 10 years. And I was there to help with a meeting for Foster the City. And there was a few minutes left in the church service, so I went and slipped in. And my college pastor, who's the pastor there, Kurt Jones, he came up, he saw me. Eli was there with me. He said, hey, would you come up on stage and pray for Glenn? Glenn Miller is about to leave for Zimbabwe today at 4 p.m. Glenn Miller was my senior pastor at this church. If you want to have a sense of who I am and kind of how I got here, it's not just that Jesus pointed me in the right direction. He causes us to be born again into a family. And Glenn was like a spiritual father to me. So I said, of course I will. So I found myself up on stage with Glenn to my left and Kurt to my right. As I walked into Valley Church's sanctuary, I hear Glenn Miller teaching from 2 Timothy on finishing the race. I couldn't believe it was a perfect passage for Glenn Miller to be speaking on. We called him the coach. because he was an actual coach, and that's the perfect passage to be hearing him preach on. So as I'm up there standing in the middle of Kurt Jones on my right and Glenn Miller on my left, and I'm laying hands on Glenn to pray as he's going to go off and leave this country for a different country where he serves orphans, I just was overwhelmed. I thought, God, you've been so good to give me people to imitate. You've given me people who know the way, and I can just follow in their footsteps and walk alongside them. These two men represented years of my life as they invested in me. Maybe you're here and you're a Christian and you don't have a church home. Can I just invite you to Neighborhood Bible Church? This is a church filled with rookies and veterans. You hitch your life to a veteran. You say, hey, I know mentors aren't perfect. Paul says that a few verses earlier. It's not that I've arrived. Mentors aren't perfect, but you know what they are? They're present. They're flesh and blood. You hear their voice audibly. And you get to just connect with them and hear from them and bounce ideas off of them. And sometimes just sit and marvel and kind of watch them live. That's what mentorship looks like. So for a month now, the amazing Tao has been painting a picture off to my left. And we discussed this passage about 5 weeks ago, maybe more. And we sort of went back and forth for about a week. Do you have your mic? Is it there? There it is. I wanted to just get some words from Tao to tell us a little bit about what she's been painting. It's been a bit of a mystery to you, but not to me. I've been loving watching this unfold with this very passage in mind. So, Tao, tell us a little bit. Come on up here. Give it up for Tao. She was such an easy yes. Jen came up with this idea, and like, let's ask her. She's like, yeah, sure, let's do it. So you've been painting now for the better part of a month in here in front of us with your non-musical instruments, painting this picture. Tell us a little bit about what this painting is talking about and sort of how it ties into this morning.
Good morning, everyone. For me, this painting represents my journey of sanctification, going through this process of learning how to be a Christian and maturing, so like Dave says. And this journey is full of joy. Where I'm in the midst of the ocean, there's lots of things happening, but there's so much joy. And as you're traveling through the world, through the journey on a ship, one of the most important things, like Dave said, is your heading. Because if you're captain of a ship and the heading of the ship is off by 2 degrees, within 20 minutes, you can be off by miles. Within hours, you're nowhere going toward land. So one of the most important things for me is figuring out how do I point myself in the right heading. And for me, the first thing that influence, like, what is my heading, is God. So you can see that the sun represents God, and he's always shining love and warmth over earth, to which all life happens, is this warmth and the sunlight. And then the second thing you might notice is this big ship in the center. There are three crosses that represents Jesus Christ's resurrection. And there is a story in the New Testament where he tells Simon, follow me, I'll make fishers out of men of you. So the smaller ship is a fisherman's ship. And there's this one person trying to learn how to catch fish following Jesus Christ. But it's also a representation of the bigger ship is the more mature Christian, the elder, leading someone like me, a rookie, you know, just learning how to figure out the way. So I'm following the older, more mature Christians as well through this journey, following God, following Jesus, listening to the Bible, and learning among a really beautiful, loving community. And through this journey, we journey through a rugged terrain on the left side. And as the story goes, and as we're learning, at least for me, my heart and my mind blossoms. So there are thoughts that have never been there before. It grows and it blossoms. And I'm learning more about the fruits of the Spirit. So it's internal changes that happen first. And these internal changes reflect out externally in the way I interact with other people, in my relationships with other people, in all the choices and actions I make. It caused all these beautiful things to happen. I'm having the best time of my life. And then finally, I think that this journey continues with our legacy through our children and our grandchildren and all the people who follows along the way. So it's a journey of sanctification, and it's full of joy and love in this beautiful ocean.
Awesome. Tal, thank you so much. So she's going to continue and finish up there. We're going to wrap up with a song, but just before we do, by the way, I'd encourage you, come take a closer look before you leave if you would, if that would minister to you. But Paul says this, he's writing to the brothers and sisters at Philippi, and he writes these words. He says, "Join in imitating me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us." Again, I just want to invite some of you who are longtime Christians. Could this be a new season? God is blossoming new things in you, that there are people that you are inviting. Hey, join me. Not just join me this Sunday, but join me in life. Let's go through this journey together. We need people. I promise you there are people around you who need that. Some of you might be willing to say what Tao did, and Tao's a relatively new Christian. She's also a pilot, so when you were talking about heading and direction, I thought, boy, Tao understands those things well. But Tao has humbled herself to follow Jesus first and foremost, and then other brothers and sisters around her as they follow Jesus Christ. And the growth in you, Tao, has been really, really amazing. One of the great things we have as Christians is the rite of baptism. It's where we're called to follow the Lord Jesus' example. It's a picture, isn't it, of being dead and buried under the water and being raised to newness of life. Can I just celebrate? We've had 11 baptisms this year at Neighborhood Bible Church. That's amazing. And I would just say that's all glory to God moving in our midst. If you have not taken a step of baptism as an act of faith, I would invite you to come and find out more. We'll be having a class coming up very soon about that. Would you close your eyes just for a moment before we close in song? God, thank you for meeting us where we are at. God, thank you so much for this church, this place, these people. God, forever begins right now. There are so many gifts and blessings. There are blossomings that are going on, seen and unseen, right now. But God, we reaffirm today our greatest hope, our greatest joy is yet to come. And so God, we just receive your blessing today. We receive the joy that comes with the resurrected Jesus Christ. Amen.